Hello there. Hermann Nitsch passed away earlier this week, and we wanted to begin today's show with a conversation about why the contemporary artist was not just important, but also quite controversial.
Hermann Nitsch was never afraid to show what is hard to watch for many. Live performances with blood, urine, naked people, and slaughtered animals. But he says this is no spectacle, that each element had a purpose.
The form of art is also very important to bring all this violence and all these sadomasochistic elements in our consciousness and make us free.
Critics didn't agree, and they included the Austrian Catholic Church, which derided Viennese Actionism, the artistic movement Nietzsche founded. It included his long-running Orgies Mysteries Theatre. The police even broke up the performances, and Nietzsche went to jail multiple times. But instead of horrifying the audience, Nietzsche aimed to do the opposite and give a sense of catharsis. According to one psychoanalyst, Nietzsche had a way of unearthing people's unconscious desires. According to the documentary H.N. Hermann Nietzsche, he was maybe more than an artist. His supporters followed him devotedly, almost like a religious leader.
When you learn about his life story, then you ask yourself some questions that mostly deal with sociology or mass psychology.
But Nietzsche's later works took on a different tone. One of his last exhibitions was at his own museum in Austria that was entitled New Works. Gone was the blood, and instead, colorful paintings from the last couple of years were on display. The curator said they're life-affirming and are inspired by peonies and spring flowers. And while it's a bit ironic that he would go out this way, it's also appropriate, because while Nietzsche was raw and serious, he was also comical, which can be felt in his comments about death.
Death is just like the car's noises. Both exist, and we have to deal with them both. We live in this world, and we have to make the best of it.
Let's talk to Hubert Klocker, the director and chief curator at the Sammlung Friedrichshof Museum. Hi there. Good to have you with us today. Now, you at the Friedrichshof Collection, you own the most extensive private collection of the works by Viennese Actionism artists from the 60s and 70s, including Hermann Nitsch's works, of course. Tell us why you are so invested in these works.
So I met Nietzsche when I was very young, and I just became interested in contemporary art. This was in the mid-70s, actually. And he was quite an influential person in my life, I must say. Later, when I started to study, I was interested in the, from the performative theory side to work on his theater and the Orgie Mystery Theater on in theory. And so it developed, you know. I mean, over the time, over the years, I started to curate shows. I did one of the first large museum shows in Austria and worldwide with a show in 89 at the Albertina in Vienna. And I did several shows international with international projects, and later I started to run the Sammlung Friedrichshof. So I've always been involved with Nietzsche, and he's a good friend. He was a good friend. I miss him, and we lost a great person.
And how do you think his work has changed the discourse around artistic freedom?
Well, you know, Austria used to be not the most progressive country in the 60s and 70s. After the war, the country had to get together again. The reaction of the people in Austria had been looking backwards to the good times, when still the Habsburg Empire was existing, and because Austria, from the political side of view, had a terrible first half of the 20th century. It was all destruction and death. Only in the 50s and 60s, the country took up again contemporary art, and Nietzsche played a very decisive role in bringing more freedom, a more extended understanding of art in Austria. And he was a challenging character, but he was also highly intelligent. And over the years, people started to kind of accept what he did. And in the last years, mm-hmm. he had lots of admiration and success.
Yeah, you called his work challenging a few times during the course of the interview. Do you think there needs to be some sort of an ethical framework to, you know, what's challenging and, you know, for challenging to be valuable? And do you also think that this was an issue with Nietzsche's work, as some people, you know, put forward or argued?
Yeah. I mean, Nietzsche was an artist who wrote extensively about his own work. And he always tried to talk to people and analyze the situation. He tried to make them understand, but he also met a lot of bad reactions, mm-hmm. of course. He was an ambiguous person, very ambivalent, and his art could not be understood by people right from the beginning. You know, so mm-hmm. you have to deal with it. You have to get. You have to think about it. You have to read about it.
Yeah.
And
Hubert, sorry, can I cut you off there? Something that's really interesting about Hermann Nietzsche for me is that he repeatedly said that he never wanted to provoke anyone with his art. But then provocation goes hand in hand with whatever he did and he put out there. So how does that come into being as a close friend and as his collector? How do you see that?
Well, I mean, Nietzsche had been foremost interested in developing his work and making a stand, and he did not. He was not at all somebody who would use shock or scandal in a strategic way. It's just about his art, and he started to deal, of course, with difficult topics. There was the 50s and the 60s when he grew up. It was the time to heal Austrian society after the Nazi domination in the 30s and 40s, and of course after the Second World War. Nietzsche lost his father in the war, and he lived with his mother when he was a young guy. He saw Vienna burning, the bombs falling down. It all impressed him a lot. Mm-hmm. And during his life, he had to deal with it. And The Orchid Mystery Theater, his performance, the art he did, the performative artwork he developed, deals with this kind of both mm-hmm. sides of existence. You know, you have to have, mm-hmm. destruction, death, but at the same time you have intensive life and fun and partying, and that's what his theater and his art is about.
It is very interesting, isn't it? He never wanted to provoke, he said, but then he will most probably be remembered for provocation in art history. Thanks so much, Hubert Klocker, for joining us today on Showcase. Peter Nobel is a Swiss lawyer and former university professor. And although he's collected thousands of artworks, don't call him a collector. For him, it's a hobby. Seriously, whose hobby turns into a whole exhibit that covers Andy Warhol to David Hockney? Here's Esra with this story.
Peter Nobel calls these works press art. He says the term isn't official, but he adds that a Swiss newspaper first used it when publishing an artwork in the 1970s. And that was roughly when Peter and his wife Annette became interested in collecting them.
Every day we read our newspapers. We say nothing is older than yesterday's newspaper. And on the other side, artists take out pieces, articles, photos from magazines, and make them, you know, perennial practically, and conserve them for a long time as part of their art.
Nobel says he started the collection with a single piece to decorate his office. Then he acquired thousands of them over the years. Now, a part of that collection can be seen at Istanbul's Pera Museum, including some of his favorites.
Collages and paintings here are made from newspapers. They're all based on images or words in the press. And the name of the show, well, comes from this magazine cover. And now the good news explores the relationship between media and art with nearly 300 pieces.
Organizers say the show highlights social and political milestones in the last 150 years. It focuses on how the invention of photography shaped society and how totalitarian systems affected mass media. The exhibit also tries to depict notions such as consumerism and digitalization. But Nobel insists that newspapers cannot be replaced with screens despite technical advances.
I think newspapers and especially magazines with important photos will never die.
In addition to its archival aspect, the exhibit brings together works from different genres such as Russian avant-garde and pop art by some famous names like Malevich and Andy Warhol. And Bedri Baykam's pieces are also part of the collection. His work repeatedly comments on historical events, but he says press art is not getting the recognition it deserves on the international art scene.
Collage is not easy for every collector. For instance, I've had many Turkish collectors or sometimes even foreign collectors say, "Oh, I don't understand those collages with newspapers. What is this? Is this art? Please give me some real painting." But on the other hand, we have collectors like Annette and Peter Noble who are open to novelties.
Well, just like Baykam faced criticism over his style, Peter Nobel also dealt with people who looked down on his artistic taste. But for him, press art is technically fascinating and intellectually satisfying. And more importantly, he says just looking at these works gives him great joy. Esra Dürüst, TRT World.
The Venice Biennale is exploring the connection between humans and nature with a theme called Milk of Dreams. It takes its name from a children's book on mutant creatures by Leonora Carrington. The exhibitions aim to redefine the nature of humanity and its relationship with the environment. A$AP Rocky has been released on bail after his arrest on Wednesday. He was detained in connection with a shooting that took place in November last year. The victim accused the rapper of grazing his hand. A trial is set for August. Lawyers for Alec Baldwin argue he's been exonerated in the shooting death of Helena Hutchins. They're pointing to a recent fine against the production company behind the movie Rust. It says producers failed to have any safety regulations on set and will have to pay $137,000. Baldwin fired what he thought was a gun full of blanks last year when the movie's cinematographer was shot and killed. The Obamas are ending their exclusive deal with Spotify. Their media company, Higher Ground, is reportedly looking to reach a wider audience over various platforms. It's a big blow to Spotify, which spent more than $1 billion recruiting celebrities to host podcasts. And Christie's is auctioning off a Jackson Pollock painting titled Number 31. It's expected to fetch more than $45 million next month. If that happens, it'll be the most money paid for one of the artist's works. We're seeing a resurgence in the work of Andy Warhol. That includes stories we've done on a critically acclaimed New York exhibition and an auction that's likely to be a record breaker. Now, a new documentary series is literally opening up the man's diary. Alijan has the story.
And 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, action.
Andy Warhol's greatest work of art is Andy Warhol.
After being shot by writer Valerie Solanas, Andy Warhol began putting pen to paper about his feelings. And from those scribblings, we're now getting a Netflix production called The Andy Warhol Diaries. The streamer's PR machine says the show goes behind the smokescreen to reveal unknown secrets about the artist. For example, his association with Jean-Michel Basquiat. There's an ongoing debate on whether Warhol used the rising star to keep himself in the headlines, or if it was Basquiat who wrote Warhol's coattails. Reviews say the documentary reveals the truth, but outside of that tidbit, the show can fall flat. For instance, we're told we'll learn about Warhol's mysterious, almost alien persona. But what that really means is a dive into his poor, immigrant roots. An origin story that's really not all that uncommon for most Americans. CNN laments that the show barely penetrates the artist's protective shell and concludes it's frustrating. Nevertheless, 2022 remains fascinated with Warhol, beginning with a New York exhibition called Revelation, and continuing next month with a portrait of Marilyn Monroe that could break records at the auction house.
I'm now joined by Jessica Beck, a curator at the Andy Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Hi there, very good to have you with us today. Thanks so much for taking the time. Now, we said we're seeing a resurgence in the work of Andy Warhol recently. Do you observe that in your museum as well? How are people's reactions to Warhol's work and, you know, Warhol, the artist in general in Pittsburgh?
Yeah, definitely. Since the Warhol Diaries was launched on Netflix, I think everyone's talking about Warhol again, and people are really excited to come to Pittsburgh to see the collection, to see where Warhol was born, where he grew up. And so there's definitely kind of a Warhol fever going on right now.
So you have a lot more visitors now.
Yeah, I think there's just been a sort of global interest happening. People are talking about Warhol again, and they're talking about him differently. You know, people are really interested in not just the work, but the life that he led and the persona that he created and the way in which he presented himself to the world. So I think it's like a different energy that's going on around Warhol right now.
And what happened? Why are we seeing this new, different energy around Warhol these days?
I think we're all living in this digital world now where we're thinking about self-presentation in a very different way and kind of online digital personas. And in many ways, Warhol lived that at a time before we had, you know, cell phones or cameras in our phones or social media. And so he really kind of lived in this way where he created a social network, where he presented himself to the world by recording himself constantly, whether that be tape cassettes or recording in the studio or having photographers around, having a photographer follow him on trips. So I think that this kind of digital world that we live in now, where we're thinking about global presentation, Warhol was living that in the 70s and 80s before this era. He was almost ahead of the wave in many ways.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the interest in Warhol never seems to go down. Yes, it might be a little more than usual these days. Then, you know, I want to ask you, what would it take for Warhol's works, Warhol's art, to be a thing of the past? I mean, is this ever going to happen, or is he going to stay relevant like this forever?
I think the work just continues to grow, and the value of the work continues to grow, and there's something about the work that he tapped into this very American subconscious fantasy, whether that be fame or beauty or class ascension. And so I think we're still living with that today. Americans are still living with these same concepts. And I think that that's why the work continues to remain relevant.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think we know a lot about Andy Warhol. There are sides of him that, you know, everyone, pretty much a regular American, would definitely know. But then now let's watch a report covering an exhibition that is focusing on a lesser known side of Andy Warhol, and we'll be back.
Andy Warhol once told an interviewer that there wasn't much about him worth talking about, that there's nothing behind the surface of his paintings and films. But the curators of the show, Andy Warhol Revelation, disagree. They wanted to reveal something that not only affected his life, but his work. The lesser-known side of him, his piety.
So as a young child, Andy Warhola, before he changed his name, visited church many times a week for very long ritual masses with his mother, Julia Warhola, who raised him in the Byzantine Catholic tradition.
The tradition is pretty much the same as Catholicism in general, but its use of repetitive icons is very noticeable. And Warhol reportedly followed the same path, seen here at the Brooklyn Museum's exhibit. Here, the reputation of crosses and angels meet pop art to explore themes such as life and death, power and desire. And being Warhol, these depictions stem from everyday objects he saw around the house.
They're in addition to over 130 artworks, paintings, drawings, films in this exhibition. We also showcase some of the kind of more personal ephemera, whether that's his mother's prayer cards, crosses that he used in artworks, images of the Last Supper that he then transformed to large 25-foot long paintings.
Curator Carmen Armo says, this show isn't only about how faithful Warhol was, but to add a complexity to his biography and let people know his inspiration didn't just come from soup cans and movie stars.
So, I mean, we all know that he was deeply interested in the concept of time and death. So I wonder what you think he would be thinking if he was alive today and he saw that his influence still carried on. Just like the first day he was out there, I mean, would he be surprised?
Yeah, I think that Warhol was someone who, while he was living and working, was thinking about what his legacy would be and was consciously working towards archiving it. And so that's why you have something like the Warhol Diaries, where he would call Pat Hackett almost on a daily basis and record what he did the day before. So there's this constant sense of archiving and recording of his own life that Warhol was doing while he was alive. So I think he's someone who was consciously connected to the idea of his own legacy and thought about how he wanted to be remembered and how he wanted to have an influence and impact after his death. And we're all living with that today. There's still so much material that has been untapped, whether that be Warhol in photography, Warhol in television. You know, there's all of these sides of our collection that haven't fully been mined yet. And so I think that's all because Warhol was archiving constantly while he was living and thinking about what his legacy would be like after his death.
Well, you know, we're out of time. It was very good to have you with us today. Thanks so much for joining us, Jessica Beck. Now, Warhol Mania might produce a $200 million price tag for a portrait of Marilyn Monroe. Here's Zeynep.
In 1964, performance artist Dorothy Podba asked Andy Warhol if she could take a couple of shots of his Marilyn Monroe paintings. Simple enough, thought Warhol, but instead of picking up a camera, Podba took out a gun and started firing. Warhol eventually patched up the bullet holes, but nevertheless, they became known as the Shot Marilyns. Film producer Peter Brandt bought the light blue one in 1967 for a steal. In today's money, he paid only around $40,000. In 1994, Greek billionaire Philip Niarchos bought the red Marilyn for $3 million. A few years later, the orange one went for $17 million, and supposedly it was sold again to hedge fund tycoon Kenneth C. Griffin for more than $200 million. Now, Christie's is putting Sage Blue under the hammer.
Shot Sage Blue Marilyn by Andy Warhol, coming to us from the Thomas and Doris Aman Foundation. Painted in 1964, this Marilyn portrait is one of the most iconic, if not the most iconic and transcendent images of the 20th century.
Smell like a dime store, I know what that means.
Sure,
I'm meeting somebody.
Warhol based all of his Marilyn paintings on a publicity photo from the movie Niagara, and did so after Monroe died in 1962, almost a decade after the film's release.
Hello, please.
He first made Marilyn diptych, and then gold Marilyn. And then the shot Marilyns came a little later.
He was very careful about how to set the hair, how to set the face. Her lips are actually where they need to be. Her eyeshadow is where it needs to be. He really paid attention to it and later said that was way too complicated and he's not going to do this again.
Christie's wants to get $200 million for it. That would be the biggest price tag of any painting from the 20th century. But whether or not that's feasible is for now a shot in the dark.
That's it for this episode of Showcase. Our YouTube channel, Instagram and Twitter accounts have more from the world of arts and culture. I'm Elif Bereketli. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.